you're not a worth member of society, and people think, you know, just because you have a degree or something. Now there is an illusion of empowerment that's created for an individual through glorification. And our fourth argument, which will be handled by my second speaker, will deal with the effects of coagulation of degree holders in society through the glorification process itself, right? Now, before I move on to my first argument, are there any POIs from this side of the house? So seeing none, let me deal with my first argument itself, right? Which is essentially fueling this dependency culture through glorification, right? Now, let me talk to you what we mean by that, right? We analyze, ladies and gentlemen, or we identify, right, that perhaps when this, let's say Sri Lanka, taking Sri Lanka as an example, we say when the free education bill was passed so many years back, there were several aims through this bill itself, right? Firstly, they tried to essentially reduce the division between classes in society. They tried to improve, let's say, their human capital, and they, let's say, tried to reduce the unemployment rates, right? But we say the realities in 21st century are very, very different, right? And we say the problem is the element of glorification that started off so many years ago is still continuing to this day, and that is a problem that we recognize, right? No, thank you, ma'am, right? And we say, what do we essentially mean by this glorification, right? What we mean by glorification is the fact that you are essentially told, one, that you cannot be who you want to be without a degree, right? And on a second level, we argue the problem is that we define glorification to say this whole mentality where people tell you that your degree is the only way out of your current circumstances, right? And we believe in both cases, glorification is wrong, right? And we also say, ladies and gentlemen, that because the may it be through the state itself or may it be through societal pressures, the moment you essentially tell people that through your degree you will be employed and without your degree you are no one, the burden then shifts on the state to actually employ these people, right? The burden shifts on the state because the state or perhaps society itself is telling these kids, look, the moment you have a degree, we are going to employ you, right? And this is a big problem for us because we say that the moment you have this burden in itself, you are going to create a cycle of dependency culture itself. Now, why does this happen, right? Why does this cycle of dependency culture get created, right? We say it's because the moment you actually come out of the degree process, you look upon the state as an employer in the public context, right? That's why a lot of people go into Columbia University thinking that the moment you have your degree, I'm going to end up in a public sector job, right? Because that assures a pension, right? We say that this is a big problem for us, right? And we say the best way to actually deal with the problems we're facing in status quo is through two means, right? The first thing is we say paint a realistic picture. Go and tell people that just because you have a degree, you won't get employed. Show them the statistics of the number of graduates that are not employed after their degree, right? And the second solution that we're proposing is we fix the inefficiencies that are existing in the education system, right? And I will later prove to you as to how glorification is preventing this from happening in the long run, right? And we also say, ladies and gentlemen, that why create, and we also say, ladies and gentlemen, that why breaking this dependency culture is important, right? Is because we believe that we live in an era where the state is essentially burden pushed to the wall to provide everything for you, right? And we believe that this is not essentially fair because this essentially results in several trickle-down effects, right? We say we live in an era where sometimes employers value job experience over degree itself, right? And these realities need to be portrayed. Now, before I move on to my second argument, yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, so your realistic picture in this context would be basically pledging to students that they don't need a university degree.
Not essentially. We are not essentially discouraging tertiary education, right? We are saying if you want to do a degree, go ahead, do a degree. But we are not going to go to that extent and tell them that the moment you have a degree, we are going to employ you or someone else is going to employ you, right? Now, let me move on to my second argument itself, which is how glorification is a deterrent of improvement. A classic example being, ladies and gentlemen, is a monopoly of education that exists in current status quo, right? We say that the government in Sri Lanka, for example, let's say the University of Colombo example, what we realize is that in ground realities, people in Anuradhapura believe that they can essentially be their best selves if they, let's say, go to Columbia University, let's say that as an example, right? But what this results in is they never talk about how Columbia University rankings have been dropping through the years, right? In terms of the quality that is being provided, right? And we also recognize, ladies and gentlemen, that because of the ground reality itself, what we essentially recognize is that this is essentially allowing the state to have a monopoly over education itself, right? And we further analyze that another issue with that is that families go to every extent to provide education to their kids, right? Now, finally dealing with this illusion of self-empowerment, right? We say that kids are lost in the status quo. That's why the moment you fail your A-levels, you are essentially pushed by your families to do your A-levels three or four times, right? Because you feel that that is essentially going to result in some sort of social empowerment or self-empowerment. And we believe on all these accounts to side with our side of the house.
honorable speakers, members of the proposition, and my fellow members. The topic at hand today is that this House regrets the glorification of tertiary education, and we as the opposition stand firm against the motion today. Now, before I address the substantive brought up by the proposition, I will first establish the House, the context of the debate today, and what exactly we're dealing with as a nation. Then I will go for two rebuttal points brought up by the proposition, and then I will bring to you in my substantives exactly why we do not regret the glorification of tertiary education today. The proposition has what needs to be understood, ladies and gentlemen, here is that in the context of a Sri Lankan nation, we are developing, right? We are developing to the point where the citizens in our country do not even reach the minimum wage, do not even reach minimum levels of sustainability, do not even have the lowest standard of life that is attainable. They live on this margin, they live on this borderline, right? I will take your point later, ma'am. Thereby, we need to understand here that they in themselves, they are not equipped. They do not have any sense of backing. It is only a very few percentage that are equipped with finances that do have resources. So when we take the country as a whole, we're looking at a very, not essentially a poverty-stricken country, but a country that is, that faces poverty as a massive social issue. And when you look at citizens in this nation, we are in fact poverty-stricken, right? So which is why we believe that in the context of the debate today, that this motion is primary, and that we do not regret glorified tertiary education, because we believe, in my first substantive, that it is an incentive to students. What you need to understand here is that when you look at primary education and secondary education, what is the context of primary education and secondary education in the nation today? It is in fact free education, right? So once you've completed your primary and secondary education, tertiary education is sort of the goal in a game of football. I will take your point later, ma'am. So it sort of ties up both primary and secondary education together, and which is why we believe that it is essential in a country where we provide free education, it is essential that tertiary education is completed, because not only will it be a complete time point to education as a whole, but it will also further incentivize these children that come from extremely poverty-stricken families that are not in a position to equip themselves without education. Ma'am, a classic example is, yes, we all know the example of Albert Einstein, but are we all Einsteins? Can we all fend for ourselves here relying on the power of our brains? No, we cannot. In a world where everything is so competitive, it is this government believes that it is essential that students be incentivized, and we believe that incentive comes in the form of tertiary education, right? Where students are put on a platform to seek out education in the forms of jobs. I'll take it by name. Now, one of the main point brought up by this opposition today, they said that a degree holder is not guaranteed a job. Now, ma'am, what is your realistic perspective of the situation? Are you saying that just because they're not guaranteed jobs, means that they need to like sit back and do nothing because they're not going to get jobs anyway?
Right.
What we're saying is, no, we need to equip these students so that they at least have the possibility of a job, even if it's a minimum, even if it's an internship where you're paid a 15 or 20,000 level, which puts you above the minimum wage level, you're still paid a certain salary where you're in a position to fend for yourself, where you're in a position to gain some sort of independence. And thereby we believe that this government's take on where you're not guaranteed a job and thereby we don't need to glorify it is utterly redundant. I would take it quite seriously. It's utterly redundant in this sense. Also, let me progress to my second substantive, which is, why don't we regret glorification? Now, glorification, why don't we regret glorification? I will analyze this on two levels, right? My first level of analysis is when you look at it in the forms of a developed country. Now, if a developed nation, in terms of, they said USA provides student loans, like why do they do this? Because they want to better equip their students, right? If a developed nation like that stops incentivizing this education, then what happens? That development is inherently going to stop. There is going to be a certain degree of lethargy within citizens where they do not need see the requirement to get into university, and thereby it will inevitably hinder their education, and thereby it will inevitably hinder development as a whole. Now, if you look at it in a second level of analysis, which is developing nations. Now, developing nations, this is the crux of the matter, ladies and gentlemen, where it is developing nations that need it the most. Because we see university education as a part to development, because yes, we understand that there is limited employment available, but by pursuing education opportunities such as tertiary education, it will better equip students. And even though in the short run they might not be employed, in the long run there is definitely employability, right? So thereby we do not see it as an excuse. Just because there are no jobs doesn't mean you get to sit on the sidelines and say, okay, just because I don't have, just because there is a shortage of jobs, I'm not going to go ahead and get a degree, right? Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, are you principally for a person taking a high interest student loan after listening to a seminar which says that he's going to get his job?
Thank you for your question, ma'am. I believe that is answered to you by the freedom of choice, yeah? So when you say the freedom of choice, people here, they have a right to choose what they want to do. In your definition, you came and told us that, you know, we limit what they want to do. But here we're saying have a tertiary education, but have it. Have a tertiary education in the field of your choice, but have a tertiary education anyway. Ma'am, if you want to be a graphic designer, there is a degree course for graphic designers. Whatever creative path you want to pursue, there are forms of tertiary education for each and every part there. Thereby, no means do we hinder the right of choice, but we are saying make a right of choice, but make that choice with regards to tertiary education, thereby stabilizing your future, right? My third substantive, it is mainly focused on the purpose of tertiary education. Now, as I reiterated to you, the purpose is to tie up education together. And because of tying up education and because of the incentive it provides in the context of Sri Lanka government, we cannot afford to take this lethargic stance that the government is taking today. Also, what does the proposition come and tell you today? They came and said that it's a detriment for improvement, that people don't really improve. But sir, if you are better equipped, a tertiary education is an added qualification. You have more knowledge than you were in your previous past. It takes you to a better position, right? And when you are better equipped with all of these things, we believe that how is that a deterrent? How is that a deterrent when you have the right of choice to choose what you want to do? When you have the right of choice to specialize in the field that you so desire, how is that a deterrent in any sense? You become an improved citizen wholly on all levels, right? That way we believe that point does not stand in the debate today. Also, this realistic picture and an efficient system, the proposition just came and said, okay, you know, we need a realistic perspective, we need an efficient system. They failed to elaborate exactly what this efficient system curtailed, but only gave us these lethargic excuses. And thereby, we believe it's the opposition we stand for in our debate today.
Given the fact that there's proof that you aren't going to get employed even if you get a degree, bad life choices on skewed information, right? If you look, you need perfect information, and if you have perfect information, still if you think you are better off doing a degree, that sort of misconception exists in the grassroots levels of society. That's why people glorify university graduates to this certain extent. But the problem here is the fact that once they get out of the degree, although they get like a proper paper qualification, primary and tertiary education, secondary education, two tertiary education, as the fact that primary and secondary education seriously preparing you to learn stuff. Against the fact that you glorify a system that has failed and that would continue to let its students down, right? Now let's take side of the opposition's case for degrees. Are worth it, you find them not doing degrees and pursuing other avenues that could help them. 80s first step, when you have a degree, you are a really good person or you are a very educated person. But the problem, or a very employable person, but the problem is you are coming from also education to make sure that you are more suited to handle practical situations. Like we can know, real life is not is something that the tertiary education system has failed in doing so, right? Now moving on to extending our argument on the notion of self-empowerment, right? So now the way we do creating this, because the simple illusion that they get you information, right? A lot of graduates are just saying most people to be able to include these sort of things. And if you do this whole idiot mentality that we want to get, is that they will suddenly be better off when you mention it. Because people aren't better off when they get a qualification out there, but people are better off when they can get money, when they can inject cash into their family system so that people will be better under it. That's a fundamental assumption, right? We tell you the reason why people slap up is because social pressure on. I say that you're worthless when you have an argument on defensive fluctuation of degree. What is it for you? Yes,
sir.
Thank you. wage to go down, right? Companies can simply force these people to work the minimum wage possible, right? Because that is regret glorification of tertiary education. But the next problem, ladies and gentlemen, is when it comes to things like student loans, when it comes to countries like United States, right? We tell you things, all the in countries like United States, kids are take student loans when they're 60, when they can't. When they go to college, and we tell you these people work on minimum wage and try to pay off their student loan, which is a huge amount. And we tell you these people throughout their life, for the rest of their working life, will have to pay the student debt. And we tell you this is a massive problem when it comes to these kind of countries, because these kids are forever tied into a vicious system where they have to pay off this debt. Now this would have been fine if they had like proper employment and if they properly get work, but you know that's not the case. And even in United States, there is a big amount. The big rise in unemployment. Really, even in countries like United States, you see things like gender studies, things like social sciences don't necessarily get the amount of jobs that get the amount of jobs required to the amount of people who pass out of university, right? So the disproportionality of that sort of thing as well. So we tell you people are caught in this vicious cycle of not having information and getting into something that they think is glorified, but at the end of the day, keeps failing themselves and this cycle continues. Therefore, for all of these reasons, I propose you.
Thank you, Deputy Prime Minister. Now I invite the Deputy Leader of the Opposition to give his speech.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to focus few of the weaknesses that the government had, and I would move with my substantives, then I will move with the rebuttals. Some of the weaknesses that they have was they identified degree as just only a paper. It is not only a paper. It is where certify this is the qualifications that you have, the capabilities you have, and it is the paper represent which are the capabilities that you have been practiced. And again, second point, they are saying that the people have no job. Well, they have been trapped in an island mind where we talk on globalized world. We have a globalized world where all the countries, there are a lot of job market opportunities are out there which our graduates could reach. And then I will show the third weakness that they have. They had all those on their side was excuses was realities. Well, they had all the excuses not to have degrees where we brought up the point of the real reality in a country. And I will move with my first substantive, that is the labor market effect. Well, I will give you a very good example since it's Sri Lankan context which they brought up mostly. Well, in Sri Lanka we send a lot of maids to Middle East. Why? We have skilled labor and then we have unskilled labor too. Well, what we have is unskilled labor. With tertiary education, what we do is we equip the labor market, as our opposition point out, we equip them with skills, not only the paper. We don't just give a paper and okay, you have a degree, you can go. We don't do like that. We say this particular document states that you have these kind of qualifications. And if we had all kinds of like degrees and all these tertiary educations much more uplifted, then what will happen is we could have sent lot of skilled labor to other countries and earn huge amount of foreign currency for our country. It would develop our country. Again, I would like to highlight, since we are sending unskilled labor, what will happen? Our mothers will be treated bad, and the money receiving for that is really low. Our families in Sri Lanka will like decline. Mothers are gone for years, right? They only earn a few small money, and the families are devolved, like destroyed. So the whole country is in collapse. That's the reality which they don't see. If we had sent all these graduates, like who are not employed, if we reach them to other countries and if we get them employed, what is the reality that we can have? Yes, sir.
So are you principally for glorification of war to employ people more in military services?
Well, if someone like to go to military, of course they can go. If someone like to be stick with some other field, of course they can do. It's their own choice. It is their free will, right? And again, I'm moving to the next point that we will look. My second substantive is for global approach. We look at the global approach and see they are saying all the university students are protesting and all kinds of hazardous things they are talking about, right? So what is the reality? What they don't see about it? Well, the reality is, we just focus, like when you're in grade 5, you focus on that. You are in some other sections, you focus on that. But in other countries, developed countries, they focus tertiary education from the junior levels. So then they know where to go. They know their paths. So they're sticking to that. So what will happen is, they have actually glorified the tertiary education. That's what you see throughout the process. Which parties like the government, which they when they're proposing that tertiary education is not important, later matter, not important, what happened is they focus on, they're glorifying their own paradigms, which will not create such an effect. And it is boiling down to the point where this tertiary education is the ultimate goal, where you will figure out where your life will end, like whether you will end up in certain place or not. That is the particular moment. As an example, I will demonstrate. In junior levels, like in primary levels, or you can have mediocre marks, right? But if you have succeed in your tertiary education, what could be happen? Well, you can have a great life. So that is where it ends. And they are always focused that okay, you are being a graduate and you are little man. And you are being graduate and you are not getting a job. Well, I would like to focus on another point also. What is the relationship between like having a national vocational qualification? That also we do have, right? So that directly focus on job market. And level 5, they are saying national vocational qualification, saying it is equivalent to a degree holder. So it all binds now. It all works together, hand in hand. So if the system does not provide jobs, then we should. Then we should create. It is the matter of system, right? If the system does not focus on the job market and which you want, which you expect, then do make it focus to the job oriented. Then it will create solve your problem. Yes, sir. Any question?
So in order to exercise your freedom of choice to make the best decision, shouldn't people have perfect information?
That is why we are trying to create that situation too. I believe in Sri Lanka they have passed an act also on basing on that. And I would like to bring some more points, rebuttals for now. I would like to move with the rebuttals with their arguments. So the job guarantees I have answered that, and protests I have answered that also, because it is why people are protesting, because it's not job oriented, it's not the matter of tertiary education, it's the matter of education system which they are saying. And as the government, people are also like boxed, they are not thinking outside the box, and they could reach to globalized world. If they do, then all the problems will be solved. And also they talk about the public sector. The government students are focusing on public sector. Well, a person who's living in Anuradhapura, as they have told, if they are suffering with some kind of a situation, if they want to change their ambition, the only solution, like if their fathers are farmers and having a background like that, if that person want to be working in NASA or somewhere, having a great degree of like different choices in life, the motivation which will carry that person or the ability which will guide them is none other than having a graduate degree or having a tertiary education which will relate to the incident. And also, I'm not talking only about doctors and engineers and stuff like that. It could be like plumbers. It could be about small jobs too, like which can lead to tertiary education, which will fulfill job fulfillment and job creation. So it can be covered in vast areas. So do not focus only to degree to a piece of paper. It is not just a piece of paper. It's with qualifications. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Deputy Leader of the Opposition. Now I invite the member of the government to take away his speech.
Over 300,000 students are sitting their advanced level examinations, some for the second time, some for the third time. Now, team opposition stands by the 10 or 15% of the students who actually get an opportunity to enter state universities. But what they haven't told us is what happens to the remaining 85 to 90% of students who don't get that opportunity, and what are the costs that are involved in them still being tied up with this glorification of tertiary education. More importantly, ladies and gentlemen, one thing which the opening half of this debate has completely missed is that the glorification of tertiary education is varied and nuanced in different contexts. And because of the way it is nuanced and varied in different contexts, the effects that it has on those societies are also different and are in fact detrimental. And this is the extension which we are going to bring to today's debate, right? Firstly, I'm going to talk to you about how there is nuance in this glorification. Secondly, I'm going to actually talk about the economy, which was mentioned by opening government, but no clear links given to us about how this glorification is in fact detrimental to the economy. I'm going to give you three levels of analysis, and then I'm going to look at the social impacts of this. So why is glorification detrimental, or why is glorification nuanced? We say, ladies and gentlemen, in different contexts, it looks different. Because it's not only what Chilanti and them told us, it was like the idea that, you know, it's the only way out of your like bad life, or sorry life, and that if you get a degree, it's going to mean a job. There are other things that work towards the glorification of it. So for example, in the United States, it's the idea of the social experience. It's this idea of having code language that only Harvard grads know. It's about chats, philosophical chats at Harvard Square. It's about milk and cookies at night at Mount Holyoke. We say, ladies and gentlemen, that these kinds of things help towards building it. I'm not even kidding. These are things that help towards moving to that glorification, and the effects are different. In Sri Lanka, it looks very different. Because as I said, it's what Chinanti said, but it's also Sri Lankan aunties boasting to one another about how their children are doing 2 degrees. Now let me get into a small ad hominem attack. Siddharth is doing 2 degrees. They are doing 2 degrees. Chinanti is doing 2 degrees. Navindu is doing 2 degrees. That's what the glorification of tertiary education looks like in Sri Lanka. That it's not important to do 1 degree, you have to do several. And so, ladies and gentlemen, in this debate, that's what it looks like. Right? I'm going to show you what the negative effects of that as well. So, ladies and gentlemen, what are the dangerous effects of this in the United States and Sri Lanka? I'll get to that later. But we say, ladies and gentlemen, even if you're able to concede that degrees have some sort of intrinsic value in making people more civilized, like Navindu said, or in giving people skills, if a degree claims to be something that requires a full-time student to, you know, appreciate it fully, then how does collecting 2 or 3 degrees while doing a professional qualification at the same time mean you're doing it properly? We said that is how this glorification leads to failure. Because it's not just important to get a degree, it's important to get 2, which means you're not really getting the full thing out of either one, ladies and gentlemen, which means that that purpose fails. So we say, ladies and gentlemen, that that nuance in the way it applies in different contexts affects people is something that needs to be appreciated. No, thanks, sir. But let's talk to inefficiencies, right? What are the inefficiencies and how does it affect the economy? Very important. We say, first of all, we heard from team from opening government that people waste their time and money. But they didn't tell us what they meant by this. Because as team opposition said, Sri Lanka is a developing country and it's extremely important for us to develop. And one of the common complaints about Sri Lankans is that they are not entrepreneurial. Why aren't they entrepreneurial? Because the moment they are 16 or 17 years old, they are told that until basically they are 24, they are going to be studying. Because you go to your A-levels, then you go up to your degree and finish your degree, and like, with all the delays, you will be 25 by the time you get out. We think, ladies and gentlemen, if this glorification didn't exist, that people who are 16-year-olds and had that entrepreneurial spark would perhaps think about using money and starting some venture. It would mean that parents of those children, because they are not caught up in this glorification, instead of giving the 5 million for an RI degree, would give that 5 million towards the cause, towards whatever investment that they want. We say, ladies and gentlemen, that because of this glorification, you are crippling the entrepreneurial spirit of these students, because their parents aren't willing to put money behind entrepreneurial ventures, because the degree is much more respectable, a degree is a much more guaranteed thing to benefit that you will get a benefit from, and so on. So that's the first thing about wasting time and money. That's how it links to the industry economy. No, thank you. Second, how does it affect companies, and this happens negatively, right? So we say, ladies and gentlemen, that if you met a person who's been to Harvard, they think that they're pretty great, right? So we say, ladies and gentlemen, that what happens is, it leads to inefficiencies, because if the person interviewing you is a Harvard grad, and he's interviewing another Harvard grad, there tends to be this very strong old boys network that leads to inefficiencies. So a person who either went to a different university, or a person who has 10 years working experience, and can show up that Harvard grad 9 times out of 10, ladies and gentlemen, doesn't get the job because the glorification of it, because the fact that, you know, we were in the same frat house or we were in the same finals club has such a strong tie that people make bad, inefficient decisions, which means employers hire people simply because they went to the right school or went to the right university, ladies and gentlemen, instead of actually looking at their skills. Secondly, we say employers also, because they're caught up in this glorification, tend to hire people who have degrees, without looking at people who might be more able to do that job by having work experience for an equal amount of time, even without a degree. So we say, ladies and gentlemen, it leads to inefficient allocation of human resources, ladies and gentlemen. Wrong people get the jobs, that is the second level. Third level, ladies and gentlemen, it's about contributions. Because, ladies and gentlemen, people like alumna from Mount Holyoke actually give millions of dollars so that rich white girls at Mount Holyoke can have milk and cookies at night, ladies and gentlemen. It's an actual tradition. We think this glorification leads to terrible allocations of money because people give to their schools in simply to, you know, make their old universities shine, because the glorification means that their brand value is tied to the value of that university. Which means if Harvard drops in rankings, my value as a Harvard grad is going to go down. That's why instead of giving that money to like as an angel investor to someone who's willing to like develop, instead of giving that money to charity, it goes to some rich white Harvard kid, right? We think that's also a problem. But what about the social impacts, ladies and gentlemen? We told you that all you really need to do, and this is integrating some of the responses they said, they talked to us about incentivizing, right? We said the people who are able to handle tertiary education, who have decided what their path is in life, are anyway going to pursue it, ladies and gentlemen. They don't need to be told this. The problem is, what is the message sent to the people who don't make it? We say you can, A-levels can be a far less like crucifying experience if you just say, you know, the best people who get in, not everyone really fails, but the people who fail have other opportunities, right? And that getting into university is not such a big thing. We think, ladies and gentlemen, the idea that degree holders get jobs because of their degrees is nonsense. You know where molecular biology graduates from Columbia University go to? They go to MAS to do merchandising. We say, ladies and gentlemen, that suggests that people don't really get what they get from their degrees, and that doesn't really contribute to society. We've given you the analysis on how it's nuanced. We've given you the analysis how those different nuances affect directly the economic benefit of those countries in different ways. We're very proud to propose. Thank you.
Thank you, member of the government. I'd like to now invite the opposition to the floor.
Gentlemen, if there's one benefit of tertiary education, it's that Sanjit gets to come up here and be cocky about it, ladies and gentlemen. We tell you on those grounds itself, he cannot tell everything he said, every bad thing he said about tertiary education, ladies and gentlemen. And we think that this is an interesting flaw in the case, right? Because everything Sanjit told us about, everything bad about tertiary education and doing 2 degrees and, you know, whatever, is basically on the fact, on the assumption that, look, you don't need these things, that whatever education you get is unnecessary and it can be replaced by something more productive, by something more useful, ladies and gentlemen. Question number one, then why have a law faculty when you can have attorneys off of the street? Why have an engineering faculty when you can, I know, get a plumber to come up and construct bridges, ladies and gentlemen? Why have a medical faculty when you can probably get your village doctor or your village priest in fact to come and cure your diseases, ladies and gentlemen? This is what Sanjit inherently missed out on, ladies and gentlemen. Glorification is not, you know, some random thing, some random concept that comes out of nowhere. No, thank you, sir. It's something that is actually rooted in proper fact, ladies and gentlemen. People like doctors and engineers and lawyers, whatever, because, you know, lawyers get you out of trouble, and the fact that that degree helped them helps to glorify the fact that it's good to be a lawyer, ladies and gentlemen. The fact that, you know, doctors cure people and engineers build bridges helps to glorify education, because there is a direct benefit to the country, to the people, and that is why people glorify it, ladies and gentlemen. No, thank you, sir. So on those grounds itself, we tell you that case is flawed. Now, for our extension for today, ladies and gentlemen, since, you know, we focused about the context, no, thank you, sir. Since we focused about, you know, higher education and all of that and how it affects tertiary education, our extension is going to be on how tertiary education actually impacts things like secondary and primary education and why that's important, especially in a country like Sri Lanka, which we think was never touched about. But before that, some rebuttal, ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, dealing with opening government. They came and they're basically, ladies and gentlemen, they came and told us, look, we're, you know, we regret glorifying education because people make bad choices, ladies and gentlemen. But if people make bad choices because they don't have the information, if they don't have the right information, then give them the right information. Don't, you know, trample something that has, well, thank you, sir. Don't go and trample something that has, that is actually the crux of a development of a country, ladies and gentlemen. That are the institutions that drive things like innovation and so on and so forth in the country, ladies and gentlemen. Stop politicians giving false quotes and, you know, stop taking it out on the education system when the problem, in fact, oh, thank you, ma'am, is actually in the corrupt political system, because that is where all of their arguments are coming from, ladies and gentlemen. No, thank you, sir. Politicians are making false promises. You know, they tell you, okay, we're going to give you a job if you have this thing to get their votes or whatever, ladies and gentlemen. Stop that from happening and don't trample on education. secondly, they conveniently ignore everything, you know, every other part of the world. You never see Singaporeans complaining about their very tough education system. And I mean, recently the United Kingdom started copying Singapore on education. You never see people in New Zealand complaining about their tertiary education system, ladies and gentlemen. We tell you that's because there are direct benefits, like I told you before, and they completely ignore it. On a last level, ladies and gentlemen, they told us that, look, you know, there are no jobs for people who actually graduate from universities and therefore, you know, don't go to university, ladies and gentlemen. Then they need to tell us how not going to, thank you, sir, how not going to university is going to give those people jobs, ladies and gentlemen. Because we tell you, if there are no jobs in the country, it's because the economy is not being driven, it's because there's no innovation, there's no research and development, ladies and gentlemen. There are no industries to work in. So we tell you, to create those industries, you need things like universities, you need institutions that actually research into, actually do career research and development. So on those grounds, we tell you there's an inherent problem, it's a mismatch. Thank you, sir. Last, ladies and gentlemen, Sanjit came and talked about how, you know, there's an inefficient allocation of resources, ladies and gentlemen. Why? Because, you know, because now people are going into tertiary education and companies don't have people with work experience and so on and so forth. First of all, ladies and gentlemen, we tell you the competition that comes through tertiary education actually helps to drive everything that they wanted, ladies and gentlemen. Because inherently you're identifying a pool of people within whom there is going to be competition. You see people in universities doing things like internships and so on and so forth. They're doing this because of the fact that, you know, they want to advance in their careers, and we tell you that university education they get is actually a huge help in that regard. So we tell you, ladies and gentlemen, thank you, sir, thank you, ma'am, that, you know, there is inherently no inefficient allocation of resources, ladies and gentlemen, and because of the fact that, you know, these people do participate in the labor force. Now moving in, sir, to my argument, but before that, yes, sir.
Sir, tell us how, on the one hand, you are going to give them accurate information about university education, but still stand by glorifying it. What would that message look like?
Sir, you glorify tertiary education because it's good to be a doctor, it's good to be an engineer. You don't give them false information in the sense, you know, you don't say we are going to hire you just because you become a graduate in, you know, whatever things that there are in terms. For ladies and gentlemen, it's as simple as that. Now, moving into my first argument on why tertiary education is actually important for things like primary and secondary education. First of all, ladies and gentlemen, we tell you that in things like budget allocation, in things like, you know, deciding where your GDP goes, we tell you there's a tendency to allocate lots of money for things like war, ladies and gentlemen. And we tell you that in the case of, you know, countries going to war, this especially happens in countries like the United States, the United Kingdom, and so on and so forth, we tell you, you tend to deprioritize education as, you know, something that is unnecessary, and so on and so forth, ladies and gentlemen. We tell you to fight this kind of deprioritization, to fight the kind of, you know, stigma that, you know, that the government tries to place on you, that, you know, war is more important, to basically not let a bunch of old men, no thank you sir, decide that, you know, they want to go to war with Iraq as opposed to build a new university or whatever. We tell you, you need people to glorify education, you need people to want education, ladies and gentlemen. And we tell you that a large part of this influence comes from tertiary education, because when you see that Harvard has invented a new warp drive or whatever, when you see that Princeton or Stanford or whatever came up with a new medicine or new whatever, ladies and gentlemen, when you see that there's a cure for AIDS, we tell you that people are actually impressed by education. And when governments try to cut down on their budget allocation for things like education, we tell you the people are going to take a stand against it. And it's important that people take a stand against it and that people care about it, because these things, ladies and gentlemen, the amount of money that you allocate in your budget for education also impacts things like primary and tertiary, primary and secondary education, ladies and gentlemen, which are the basis of everywhere in the world, ladies and gentlemen. You identify that the right to education is a basic human right, and that's because having that primary and secondary education actually sets you further apart from a lot of people, and it actually enables you to take up so many more opportunities, ladies and gentlemen. So we tell you, on those levels, it's important that people recognize the importance of tertiary education, and this goes towards that. Now moving into my last argument on what it means for the economy, ladies and gentlemen, we tell you, on a very first level, research and development, ladies and gentlemen, you need research and development and innovation if you want to come up with new things, especially in today's world where, you know, you can't really develop unless you have a competitive advantage over other countries. And that competitive advantage comes from you identifying new methods, you know, cheaper processes of producing the same thing, ladies and gentlemen. Those things are driven by universities. So if you don't have that kind of funding, if you don't have that kind of influence from universities, if people don't realize and appreciate universities, we tell you, you will never have these new industries, you will never have a competitive advantage, and countries like Sri Lanka will always stagnate on the economic side inside of Asia.
Thank you very much for the decision. Now I invite the Gandhi Web.
house, a degree doesn't define you. The burden on side proposition today wasn't to prove that university education is not important. The burden on side proposition was to merely prove to you why glorification itself is harmful. We are not here to tell you, look, people shouldn't go to university. No, we tell you, look, university education is important. People should go to university, but you don't need to glorify it to the extent that we see today. There are people who actually don't have a passion in education actually go and try to become an engineer or a doctor simply because of the prestige associated with it, right? We have to understand this nuance, because a lot of the arguments coming from side operation simply told us and pushed the burden on us as to why universities itself is beneficial, and then you are depriving them of all these benefits, right? Which is not quite true. So I move on to three clashes on this debate, right? Firstly, I'll be talking to you about incentive, which side actually incentivizes better, and secondly about the economic aspect, and thirdly about social harms that we portrayed to you, right? So on the first aspect of incentive. So they told you, look, glorification is necessary. It's an essential incentive. If you don't have this, people won't go to university. We don't see that as being a fact, right? We tell you, if I am a person who actually has an interest in math, if I enjoy doing sums or whatever, then I'll essentially go to a field that I enjoy, in a sense, doing math, right? But if I'm an artistic person, if I'm a person who actually likes music, I might go into that particular category. They have to tell us as to why it's okay for you to force people who might not even like to go into, let's say, to become an engineer or to become a doctor, into becoming that particular person. We tell you that kind of incentive is harmful, because you are essentially forcing people to do something that they might not actually have a passion for, right? So at the best case scenario, these people that you are forcing to, who would not otherwise go, will essentially do their job without satisfaction, right? They won't be happy through because of this glorification, because you're telling them, oh look, you're defined by your degree. If you don't do this, you are less valuable human being. These people, they will simply put aside their passion and go in chase of these degrees, right? That is the problem we have in status quo. They have to tell us why that incentive is harmful, right? Because a person who is not suited going to university has certain harms. That person might simply drop out at the end of the day. And as Sanjit told you, look, just because of this glorification, people try and do multiple degrees because it gives them a higher social status, or it might make them more eligible to get a job, like we see in a lot of people, right? Look around you and actually see how many people around you actually do more than one degree in the status quo, and not everyone succeeds in it. Just because you try and go and you incentivize people to get into university does not essentially mean that they'll pass out, that they'll actually do well in university, that they'll actually learn studies and get an employment. That's a very big logical leap which they did not prove. We tell you, in our paradigm, these people who don't have an interest in pursuing academics will truly not go into these universities. But we told you why that is beneficial, because Sanjit told you, look, there will be more entrepreneurial ideas coming out in the society. We tell you, look, universities essentially is restricted to a certain set group of avenues. There are people who don't go and experiment other avenues, because those avenues might not yield results as of right now. But those avenues will be explored now, because people will be more free to choose what they actually want to do and pursue this avenue. They have to tell us why this is harmful. Now, secondly, on this aspect of poor, that these poor people essentially need this incentive. We tell you that is again a fallacy, because we tell you, when these poor people actually go to these universities, what happens is they try to manage a part-time job while they are doing their university and whatnot. And in some cases where they don't actually want to do it, where they might not have a passion to do it, they'll essentially not do it properly either, right? Because of these conditions. Whereas it's far better in our paradigm if you actually go and take a job when you're 16 rather than spend 5 years in the university where you are not assured of a job anyway, right? We told you in that sense that the government cannot simply tell you, look, it's more important that you go to university as opposed to you getting a job, especially in the context of a poor person. They have to engage in that, right? And this incentive, this social stigma is particularly harmful, and it's particularly it particularly affects poor people disproportionately, and that is why it's harmful, right? Not right now. And then they told us, oh look, if you don't have this incentive, people will slack off, they won't simply do anything. We told you this is a complete fallacy, right? People would still have an urge to do something because of their passions, because they want to earn a living, for crying out loud, right? People won't simply sit back and do nothing, right? Before I move on to your point.
Sir, would you regret hospitals? Because some people who go to hospitals end up dying.
That's not what we are saying, right? That has no, we would not regret hospitals because people, some people go to hospitals and end up there. What you are saying is, what you are essentially doing by this motion is putting people who actually don't want to go to hospitals into going into hospitals, right? If you are telling them, oh look, if you have a scratch in your arm, you might as well go to hospital. We tell you that's a waste of resources. We don't want to go with that. So moving on to our second argument about economic aspect, right? So this where Siddharth told you about R&D and university and whatever, right? We tell you this is not essentially mutually exclusive because we did not stand for context where we don't have tertiary education. R&D will still happen in our paradigm. You will still get budgets for education in our paradigm. But if anything, you'd have better people who actually care and who actually have an interest in that particular subject, pursuing that subject. And we believe that in itself is good for the subject itself. You'd have better R&D because people would be more responsive to what they say. People would have more people would have more interest, and therefore you can continue your university education and the entire experience much better in our paradigm, because people who are not suited will not simply go in there simply because you think, oh look, you might get a pretty wife if you go to university, right? In that sense, we tell you, it's far better in our paradigm. And we told you about a lot of economic harms in this year. We told you about how it harms the economy in Sanjit's view, about entrepreneurial spirit, about how employers now can't be subjective and they simply choose people simply because of their qualification, right? And we told you how that's harmful, because there might be a person who is actually working for you, who might not simply have a degree, who has 10 years of working experience, who might be more productive than simply a graduate from some fancy university. And you are simply picking that graduate out of the glorification of this tertiary education, right? Because you place an inherent value in that degree, that person, for no real reason. And that is the type of harm that we're actually talking about. Moreover, we talked to you about social harms, right? We told you how crippling failure in A-levels is, because the auntie next door is going to tell you again and again to go and actually do your A-levels again and again, right? And about how education itself is something that excludes certain amount of people, about how some people are actually gifted at education. Some people have the innate ability to remember certain things, and therefore those people might actually be suited to doing this, but that's not something that is objectively available to everyone. A person with ADHD might not be able to go to university and compete in the same way. It's unfair on them. They are at a great harm in our paradigm. Because of all these reasons, we are very proud to propose.
Sandeep said, glorification is extremely nuanced in the context we are debating right now. And sometimes the idea of milk and cookies, or the fact that even in Tharpa's case, the fact that the idea that you might be able to get a girlfriend in your fourth day at least, is what makes university nullified. We think the fact that it makes university life bearable is what makes the glorification of tertiary education important. Because you know, there are enough and more narratives in the status quo that tells you, oh look, you don't need to have a university degree, because if you drop out, well, you are good to go. Well, we tell you there is enough and more avenues in the status quo to completely mess your life up. If you move the narrative out of university, we tell you, oh look, university education is important. If you take that avenue, what we are telling you, you are disincentivizing people from getting into university. Now, I know Tharuka decided he wanted to get into, he did math and he decided to get into faculty because he's a smart kid. But will you, all the rest of the kids who are not so smart, who are not that good at making life decisions, are going to make terrible life decisions. And that is why you need to tell them, this avenue of education is going to most likely do you want better than going into any other risky investment that you're going to draw. Because even in the best case scenario, let's assume that I'm going to tell you this is not the case. Even in Chiranti's best case scenario, well, look, an undergrad has a degree, doesn't get to work. But even in their case, you don't have a degree, you still don't have work opportunities. Because we tell you, work opportunities are created based on the kind of demand that exists in the country. That is why, when you go to universities like Harvard, the law firms want to hire you. Because that university is glorified, that degree is glorified, that qualification is glorified. qualified. That is why you want to hire these individuals. We tell you with the kind of glorification that exists right now, you're also creating opportunities as in the sense of work opportunities. Because the reason why the glorification happened in universities is because law firms tell you, become a Harvard grad, we will hire you. The reason why even countries like Sri Lanka, become a graduate from this school, we are going to hire you. We tell you, this kind of glorification exists because there is an avenue for you to actually get work. That is why there are doctors and whatnot, even if it's not doctors, that is why it exists. And lastly, the last point of contextual condition I'm going to deal with is the idea that in the status quo, and specifically in the status quo, we don't think you people are forced to do things that they don't want to do. If you think if you're an artist or a good at artist, who is good at art, because there are enough and more avenues in university that enables you to follow this kind of aspect. There are enough and more different kinds of university degrees that deals with these different kinds of talents here. So we don't think that the kind of context that Tarvi is trying to bring to the debate is necessarily true. I'm going to deal with two points of clash points. Firstly, on the value of education, and secondly, whether glorification actually creates a dependency culture. Now, firstly, let's look at the value of education. Now there's two points. I already told you, look, if you're poverty driven and if you need to take care of your family, it's better that you go ahead if you do an immediate job and give it back to the family. Really, that is not necessarily the case. Really, that perpetuates a vicious cycle because you're not going to get out of the odd job you're doing because you don't gain qualifications in the long run. Even in the worst case scenario, you have some qualification that allows you to do better, right? Let's look at the scenario, what happens right now. If one qualification is not enough, you're more likely to get another qualification. We tell you the glorification forces you to do better, to kind of multiply the kind of degrees you have, and we think that's a good thing. The fact that the reason why people gather to multiple degrees is they realize the kind of competition that exists in the workplace is this high, so you need to meet that kind of demand. If you don't give them that kind of realistic picture, if you don't force them here, you're not going to force them when you get into the workplace, so you are not going to get a job anyway. So we think that's not going to work. Secondly, we tell you, the way university life works is that you mingle with the kind of poor people. You learn the culture of the poor people. You understand there are different. You meet different kinds of people from different places in life. So that is how you network in the society. We think the fact that is a kind of environment that is glorified in university. The fact that there are different people from different parts is how you get out of this kind of power-driven situation. Because you aspire different things. You meet a friend like Sanjit who knows a lot about Harvard. You aspire to be different things if you come from a poor family. We think that's a good thing. We think that is a kind of university environment that allows you to do better. Because it tells poor people there are different avenues and we are okay with it. Go, sir.
So tell us why it's better for the development of a society to send all its children the message that it's better to play it safe and spend 3 years in university than to take a risk and do something entrepreneurial.
So it's quite simple. Because if you're playing with the risk, you're mind you lose your entire life, you're talking about, there's almost guarantee that somebody will give you a job. Even if that is not the case, you will be forced to work in and get a job. But in your case, you don't have any other alternative. You will either have to be a boss, or in your worst case scenario, you will get the most odd job available in society and you're not going to develop from that. So we think that's fundamentally more problematic than you actually getting the job in the long run, even if it means you have to spend 3 or 4 years in the university. Education. No, ma'am. Now the second point coming from this idea is that you are spending a lot of money on private education. We think that's a good thing. We think the concept of private education is what has made the concept of glorification of university culture a lot better, because you know you have to compete with students from different kinds of backgrounds, because you're bringing in knowledge from different kinds. You're talking about technological improvements, you're talking about the way people look at different things differently. And that only exists if you glorify this kind of education that exists in any country, right? And we tell you, you need that kind of vast amount of knowledge base if your country wants to develop. And we think, because country's development is not based on these odd jobs that you do, but the specialized jobs you do. And that is why you need to focus a lot more on university education. That's why the last idea. The second clash point is about whether it creates a dependence culture or not, and whether it's inherently harmful, right? Now, the we tell you the reason why it creates a dependence culture is a good thing is because politicians are forced to allocate money in their budget to education. If you don't create this kind of dependence culture, if you don't make people want to depend on the education system that is there, then there is no reason for politicians to look after education. Within the reason why that is there is because you glorify this and because people are dependent on that. We think that's a good thing. And the problem they have with glorification are problems of the problem Chirati has at least is that look, you're telling them that the state will have to give you a job. We think that's a different debate entirely. The fact that state has to give you a job is a different debate. We don't think in university education you glorify that. You glorify the idea that somebody that the state is some enough opportunities from the private sector and order that gives you a job. So we tell you it's a good thing, at least it's a sure shot in some level, at least private entities are going to take care of you, and you're forcing the state to spend on education. In their case, you're telling the state doesn't have any burden at all. You're telling you education is important, you at least, even in worst case scenario, you're still going to get a girlfriend. Thank you.
Thank you, opposition member. The judges will now retire to consider the final decision. Dear contestants, please remain seated.
Housedorf Debates 2018. Ever since founding Housedorf Debates in 2012, the debaters have evolved to a well-recognized event among university students. And this year, taking a step towards greater prospects, the English Literary Association has joined hands together with the Presidential Secretariat to bring to you National Sustainability Discourse Housedorf Debates 2018. To start the proceedings, I warmly welcome the chairperson, Ms. Nelum Jasingha, to deliver the welcome speech.
Good evening, honorable chief guest, Mr. Maxwell Parnagama, Madam Principal, ladies and gentlemen. I know these 2 days have been hectic and everyone's waiting to find out the results, so I'm going to keep the speech as short as possible. As most of you might be aware, the Housedorf Debates has been an annual event at Law College since 2012. We may have started small, but every year we grow bigger and better. And looking at the audience, I see a couple of familiar faces who've been with us throughout the journey, especially the Debaters Council and a couple of universities who always never fail to send teams for us. We are also happy to welcome a couple of newcomers to Housedorf Debates this year, especially the University of Weimar, ICBT Kandy, and the College of Chemical Sciences. We hope you guys continue to participate in Housedorf Debates in the years to come. When the Presidential Secretariat informed us that they wanted the input of the youth on the National Sustainability Report, we thought that the National Sustainability Discourse would be an ideal theme for Housedorf Debates in this year. As anyone who's been a part of Housedorf Debates over the years would know, the Housedorf Debates plays host to some of the country's most intelligent youth. We will be compiling an outcome document of all the motions that have been discussed today. And we hope this document will be valuable in paving the way for a sustainable Sri Lanka. We hope that everyone has had an eventful couple of days, and we apologize for any inconveniences and minor hiccups on our part. Back to you, Yashika.
Representatives from National Sustainability Unit of the Presidential Secretariat. Now I cordially invite Mr. Maxwell Parnagama.
Judges and special invitees and students of Law College and other institutions who are present here today. I am thankful to the members of the organizing committee for inviting me here, because this is an institution where I also acquired qualifications and did many things while here apart from academic qualifications, sports activities, etc. I was very happy that I was invited, because even with short notice, that this is an occasion where I could encourage students to engage in additional activities other than normal studies, because debating is an essential skill that you will require future in life when you are going through your work in profession. I was listening to your debate about tertiary education. I must say, and the debate was mainly on the scope of employment. I think my view is education is not for finding employment, but education is for you to become a good human being. Subject of employment is another thing. And if you become a mature, good human being, everything will follow right in your life. So that glorifying tertiary education, I must say, person who go to university and get a degree, they are supposed to do research. You are going through a degree, you are trained to think further, deep, so that you must make use of that education where you are trained to think deep, to do research. But we find today they are not directed properly. They also to concentrate on finding employment. People who don't go through tertiary education, they have skills. They learn work towards more practical side, they are in demand. So that they too also can be an opportunity later while they work to obtain the degree. They also can be part of the tertiary education. Similarly, person who get tertiary education and get a degree, who fall short of doing research, they may be trained to do work. They may be trained practically to do their work, so that it's a matter of arrangement in the system of education, and there's no need to be fighting each other. So, as regard to, I noted down something of debating. In fact, while myself being here, I am happy in my familiar surrounding, reminding of my past. Mostly, I am happy to engage in this occasion all the invited at short notice because it is an occasion where you could encourage students to engage in activities of literature apart from academic studies where it is useful to them in the future to come. Referring to some aspect of history of debating, as many as 35 different named debating societies erupted in 1780 in England. The first student debating society had been formed in Great Britain. The Cambridge Union also founded student debating society in 1850, and they claim to be the longest continuing debating society in the world. All formats of debating is almost the same, but in England and mostly in other countries, the difference are in regard to commencement of the debate and decision making given to the audience. Here we have a panel of judges. End of a debate, decision making should be based, I think, on the following, that is, first the quality of arguments, charisma of speakers, quality of humor, ability to think on the feet, nature of teamwork, and pronunciation and actions in delivering speeches. We have had many great personalities who excelled in debating abroad, Cambridge and Oxford University. Few of them are former Prime Minister, Right Honourable Mr. Istapdi R. D. Bandaranaike, Cabinet Minister Lalit Attukadmidhan, Cabinet Minister Lakshmana Kadrikar. They, after debating abroad, acquiring skills and experience, they entered in politics of this country. And they entered parliament and contributed immensely to enhance the quality of debates in parliament. And very often brought out very good arguments and analysis during legislative debates. Now, there we see those personalities they acquired at the early stage of life abroad made them good politicians and good debaters. Therefore, today, all the competitors who took part have gained a lot of experience, I am sure. They will gain advantage in future. But the students here, after qualifying, they will deviate into various professions. Some may take up to politics and go to parliament and debate. Some may opt to practice law. Some may get engaged in academic work, lecture. Some may get into administrative and business work. And all, whatever the field you choose, your experience gain and ability develop doing activities like this at the initial stages will help you. I heard that this time debating contest, so many students from various universities and academies join, and I'm sure they have gained a lot of experience. They would have got to know each other, and of course when you think of students coming from north, we also can think of these also another step of reconciliation. I must congratulate and appreciate the work done by the union, doing hard work. I think the president and the members of the union, they work very hard. It's a difficult task to gather all students from various institutions and have a successful debating competition. I know that the debates that had occurred would have been of high standard, dealing with very vital importance like the topics that they engaged today. And I hope they will continue getting involved in work and studies other than your academic studies, so that once you get into your profession, that will help you. While being a politician, a practicing lawyer, academic staff, even business, you need to be very smart and be trained to think fast on your feet. As regard to judiciary, I don't mention anything about the ability you gain from debating, because judiciary judges are generally asked to keep their mouth shut and only to hear. So I congratulate the organizing union and the competitors who join hands with the union to make this event a success. Thank you.
Maxwell Paragan, former judge of the Court of Appeal, representatives from the Presidential Secretariat, invitees, and my dear children. This is a very pleasant evening. I can see the children nicely dressed. You know, and they have organized, I think, the fellowship. I asked them whether they have organized a food bazaar. So anyway, I'm not going to talk much. Sorry I got delayed because I had to attend a religious function. That is where I studied Buddhism. That is Vajrarama Dhamma School celebrated 100 years. So children, I'm very thankful to the Law College English Literary Association for organizing this event. Even the officer who came from the Presidential Secretariat commented. Not only the Law College, I'm not praising only the Law College students, but there are lots of students come from other parts of the country. I thank you very much for being here today. And I think Honorable Maxwell Paranagamma was talking about SWRD Bandara Nayaka, Lalit Athulath Modali, and you know, our favorite, who passed away, that is, the third one, who came from the, tragic death. Right. Anyway, children, you have to improve your skills, debating skills, and, you know, if you want to become a politician, become a, I have no objections, but you have to be a good politician and you have to do politics, not politrics. Then I think I have going. This is okay. National Sustainability Discourse House of Debate 2018, and I wish I congratulate the winners, and I hope and pray that this will continue. And juniors who are here, please learn some good lessons from your seniors and how they conducted. Sometimes it's a problem for me also giving faults. Madam, I know you want this, but anyway, I didn't consider those things as problems, but anyway, I will give my fullest support if I'm here. It's okay. Thank you very much, children. I wish you all good luck and happiness and enjoy.
Thank you, madam. Moving on to the most anticipated segment of the evening, the award ceremony. We will start the award ceremony by presenting the certificates of participation. To present these certificates, I would now like to call upon our principal, Mrs. Indira Samarasinghe, accompanied by Harita Ranasinghe, co-sector head of participation, protocol and registration. First, the certificate of participation will be presented to the debaters. I request one representative from each university to receive the certificates for your university. Firstly, Asia Pacific Institute of Information Technology. British College of Applied Sciences, School of Law. Department of Law, University of Jaffna. General Sir John Cotolaville Defence University, Faculty of Law. International College of Business and Technology, Kandy Campus. Royal Institute of Colombo. Sri Lanka Law College. Faculty of Law, University of Moratuwa, Faculty of Engineering. University of Sri Jayawardenepura, Faculty of Medicine.
University of Weimar. And finally, the swing team A, B, and C of Sri Lanka Law College. Madam Principal, I call upon Fahama Abdul Latif, Co-Sector Head of Participation, Protocol and Registration, to accompany Madam on stage. We will now present the certificates to the semi-finalists. Firstly, Achievers Lanka Business School, represented by Ryanka Sinathambi and Ihan Samaravikram. University of Jaffna, represented by K. Parameswaran and K. Sivakasankar. General Sir John Kothalavala Defence University, represented by Asil Karna Singha, Rosane D'Souza, Chanelka Pereira, and Chania Ramasinghe. Now to present the certificates and award to the novice finalists, I call upon Isri Jayawardhana, Co-Sector Head of Participation, Protocol and Registration, to accompany Madam. Madam, we present the certificates. Thank you. Bye. Runner-up of the novice finals, Sri Lanka Law College, represented by Karushi Jayawardhana. Champion of Now's Finals goes to Royal Institute of Colombo, Jessica Mathias, Secretary of Hausdorff Debates 2018, to accompany Madam. I request a Royal Institute of Colombo to please come back on stage to receive the novice shield.
next to present the certificates for the amateur adjudicators. First, the certificates of participation. Thilina Mark Amar Sena, representing Asia Pacific Institute of Information Technology. Amindri Sinathambi, representing CFPS Law School. D.M. Dayalan, representing University of Jaffna. I. Janani, also representing University of Jaffna. Natasha Fonseca, representing Sri Lanka Law College. Sachitra Ratnasurya, representing University of Sri Jayawardenepura. Natasha Sirsena, representing University of Sri Jayawardenepura. On to the best amateur adjudicator awards. Best amateur adjudicator runner-up goes to Sri Lanka Law College, represented by Maya. The award for the best amateur adjudicator goes to Royal Institute Colombo, represented by Vanita Pillai. Next, to present the awards you have all been waiting for. I call upon chief guest for the evening, Mr. Maxwell Parnagama, accompanied by Madam Principal and Chairperson of Hausdorff Debates 2018, Nelum Jasinghe. The award for the best speaker. The award for the best speaker goes to Sanjit Das, representing the University of California. Congratulations, Sanjit. Job well done. Next, we move on to the results of the final debate of Hausdorff Debates 2018. In fourth place, Royal Institute of Colombo, represented by I beg your pardon. In fourth place, Asia Pacific Institute of Information Technology, represented by Amir Kali and Shari Kuala.
Bhandara, Royal Institute of Colombo, represented by Neil Mahadharamge and Siddharth Mahasi. Champions of National Sustainable Discourse Housetop Debates 2018. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a thundering applause for the champions of Housetop Debates 2018, representing Sri Lanka Law College. Thank you, madam. Thank you, sir. We call upon Mr. Chamita Dasari of the Presidential Secretariat, National Sustainability Unit, to receive a token of appreciation presented by Nilam Jaisinger, Chairperson of House of Debates.
Thank you. Finally, to wrap things off, I invite Secretary of House of Debates 2018, Jessica Mathias, to deliver the vote of thanks. I call upon, thank you, Harita. I call upon Fahama Abdul Latif, Co-Sector Head of Participation, Protocol and Registration, to accompany Madam on stage. We will now present the certificates to the semi-finalists. Firstly, Achiever Sri Lanka Business School, represented by Ryanta Sinathambi and Ihan Samaravikram. University of Jaffna, represented by K. Parameswaran and K. Sivakasankar. General Sir John Kothalavala Defence University, represented by Asil Karuna Singha, Rosane D'Souza, Chanika Pereira, and Chania Ramasinghe. Now to present the certificates and award to the novice finalists, I call upon Isri Jayawardhana, Co-Sector Head of Participation, Protocol and Registration, to accompany Madam. Madam, we present the certificates. Thank you. Runner-up of the novice finals, Sri Lanka Law College, represented by Karan Sujarasa. Of Novice Finals goes to Royal Institute of Colombo, represented by Ryan Ashwar and Ryan Kumar. Jessica Mathias, Secretary of House of Debates 2018, to accompany Madam. I request a Royal Institute of Colombo to please come back on stage to receive the novice shield. Amarsena, representing Asia Pacific Institute of Information Technology. Amindri Sinathambi, representing C. CFPS Law School. D.M. Dayalan, representing University of Jaffna. Jalani, also representing University of Jaffna. Natasha Fonseca, representing Sri Lanka Law College. Chitra Ratnasurya, representing University of Sri Jayawardenepura. Natasha Sirsena, representing University of Sri Jayawardenepura. Now to move on to the Best Amateur Adjudicator Awards. Best Amateur Adjudicator runner-up goes to Sri Lanka Law College, represented by Maya. Amateur adjudicator goes to Royal Institute Colombo, represented by Vera Pilar. Next, to present the awards you have all been waiting for, I call upon chief guest for the evening, Mr. Maxwell Parnagama, accompanied by Madam Principal and Chairperson of Hausdorff Debates 2018, Nelum Jasinghe. The award for the best speaker. The award for the best speaker goes to Sanjit Das, representing University of Congratulations, Sanjit. Job well done. Next, we move on to the results of the final debate of Hausdorff Debates 2018. In fourth place, Royal Institute of Colombo, represented by I beg your pardon. In fourth place, Asia Pacific Institute of Information Technology, represented by Amir Kali and Shari. Second runner-up, Royal Institute of Colombo, represented by Neil Mahathir Ramli and Siddharth Kumar Singh.
after 2 days of intense debate, hard work, we finally have the champions of National Sustainable Discourse Housetop Debates 2018. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a thundering applause for the champions of Housetop Debates 2018, representing Sri Lanka Law College. Chairperson of Housetop Debates. Thank you. Finally, to wrap things off, I invite Secretary of Housetop Debates 2018, Jessica Mathias, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Distinguished guests, judges, and participants,
In the development vision compiled by the Presidential Expert Committee, Sri Lanka hopes to become a sustainable upper middle income nation that is economically prosperous and advanced, environmentally green and flourishing, and socially harmonious, inclusive, peaceful and just. And this is the vision that drove Hausdorff Debates 2018. We sincerely hope that through this, we have made our contribution to the country's discourse on development. As in the words of the late American President John F. Kennedy, without debate, without criticism, no administration and no country can succeed. No republic can survive. One cannot ask for a better backing of such an event than by the people at the helm of executing this discourse, the Presidential Secretariat. We thank them for the support and resources rendered to us. Furthermore, if not for the support of our sponsors, we would not have been able to convert our plans into actions and facilitate this discussion on such a vital discourse. Also, we acknowledge Impulse, our official photography partner, and the Presidential Media Unit for being present here today. Hausdorff Debates would not have seen the daylight if not for our dear principal's endorsement of this event and her enthusiasm to maintain its standard. And in maintaining the standard, the debaters' counsels and the judges' assistance was very much appreciated. We thank the participants for their hard work, long hours of training and preparation put in for this competition, and for the enthusiasm and keenness to engage in this dialogue, which is the intended outcome of Hausdorff Debates. Last but not least, this event would not have been possible if not for the brains and brawn behind it, that is, the organizing committee of Hausdorff Debates 2018. And in furthering the committee's tasks and objectives, the support rendered by the volunteers, rapporteurs, and the advice and guidance of past committee members of the English Literary Association certainly was crucial in making this event a success. Thank you all for your hard work and dedication. It is our sincere hope that this event was a portal for like-minded students to engage in discussion on the country's future, and this opportunity was utilized to its potential. Thank you.
That concludes the closing ceremony of National Sustainable Discourse Hausdorff Debates 2018. Thank you all for being a part of Hausdorff Debates, and I hope you all collected fond memories to cherish. To continue traditions, I request you all to head outside for the Hausdorff Open Night to enjoy a scrumptious local food. Thank you.
Yeah.